And so welcome back to this Ansys video course on designing waveguides using the student version of AEDT. In the previous video, we discussed the governing equations of the circular waveguide, as well as the different propagating modes in it. And in this video, we're going to simulate a circular waveguide based on the example problem from the reference textbook, Microwave Engineering by David and Posar. We're going to look at chapter on transmission lines and waveguides. And the problem statement is as follows. Find the cutoff frequency of the first two propagating modes of a Teflon-filled circular waveguide. A equals 0.5 centimeters and the relative permittivity and the dielectric loss tangent of the Teflon is 2.08 and 0.0004. And calculation of the cutoff frequency by the equations are in terms of the Bessel functions. And not only are the Bessel functions complex in nature, but the equations are for very specific geometries. So what happens when the geometries are more complex and involves changes in the physical geometry or the materials itself? And this is when we should reach for the electromagnetic simulation tool, like HFSS, which will calculate the value of the cutoff frequency, but also allows you to visualize the E and H fields, which are necessary as per Maxwell's equations. So go to that rectangular waveguide simulation video, which can be accessed through the link on the screen to the top right, if you're a new user for HFSS or you simply want more details on the simulation steps. So let's get started. So here's the interface of the AEDT student version. Here's an empty HFSS design type. The solution type is defined as and set as modal network. In the draw tab ribbon, select draw cylinder. Select the cylinder vertices, first at the origin, next along the XY plane, and then along the positive Z direction. In that model history tree window, you now see there's an object named cylinder 1 with the material vacuum. And in the solids category, go ahead, edit dimensions of that cylinder. Double click on the create cylinder option and use variables to define the dimensions, or just simply add these specific values as in the coordinates as shown. Click OK to accept. Use the keyboard shortcut. Control D allows you to fit all the contents in the modeler window. Double click on the object cylinder 1 to open the attributes dialog box and rename it to WG underscore fill. Change that vacuum material and click on the cell, and we'll use that same custom Teflon material which we used in the rectangular waveguide module. Now change the transparency, click OK to accept the changes, and that's what we really need to do. Remember, by default, HFSS treats everything exterior to the simulation domain as a perfect electrical conductor, or PEC, unless of course the auto open option is selected. So no need to create the exterior metal housing of the waveguide. The next step is to assign an excitation along the z-axis where the signal will go into and out of the model geometry, into and out of the cylinder. Select the face of the origin along the z-axis, right mouse click, assign excitation, port, and wave port. A dialog box or wave port pops up, and the problem said enter the number of excitation modes as 5. I said 2 before, but it's 5. Click on next, keep the defaults, click finish, and repeat the same for the same face on the x-axis maximum for port 2. The next step is to add a solution setup. Right mouse click on analysis, category select add solution setup advanced, and in that pop-up window, set the single solution frequency to 17 gigahertz. Keep the default option, click OK. In that pop-up window for the frequency sweep, be sure the sweep type is interpolating. Change the start frequency to 10 gigs, the stop frequency to 25 gigs, check save fields, click OK to accept the sweep, save the project, and now we're all set to simulate. Go ahead, validate the design and run the analysis. And once the simulation is completed, let's go ahead and view the propagating modes. In that project manager window, expand the port field display. Click on the different modes to see the electric field patterns for each mode. Here is the view of all the modes. Pause the video here. Go ahead and try to identify as many modes as possible. Then continue. Take the first picture on the top left. Here you see the variation of E is along the circumference of the waveguide, as well as along the radio distance. It can be TE11, but how can we label this mode for sure? Plot the electric and magnetic fields to identify these modes, just like we did in the rectangular waveguide simulation module. And we'll demonstrate this later in this module. Go ahead, plot the cutoff frequency for these modes. How? By plotting the imaginary parts of the propagation constant gamma. And here's the rectangular plot for the phase constant with a marker to identify the cutoff frequency of these modes. The cutoff frequencies are displayed at the zero crossover point on the axis. So let's plot the E field distribution for the modes excited in the waveguide. Go ahead, switch back to the object select mode by using the O key. Select the object WG underscore fill, right mouse click, select plot fields E, mag E. In the pop-up window, under context field, go to the solution and select sweep. From that drop-down menu, select any frequency greater than the cutoff frequency of the highest mode. Check the plot on the surface only option and click done. And here's the E field plot. Go ahead, animate this plot. Go to the project manager window, right mouse click on mag underscore E1 plot and select animate. And a new window pops up. Keep all the default values, click okay. Here's a TE11 mode propagation, the dominant mode of propagation. Let's see it in vector form. For better visibility, let's go and hide that magnetic field plot. In the project manager pane, right mouse click on the plot, uncheck plot visibility. And with the front face selected, plot the electric field vector plot. Edit the attributes of the vector plot as shown. Similarly, plot and modify the vector plot of the magnetic field. Also plot the electric and the magnetic fields along the XZ plane. We'll use all of these vector plots to identify the propagating modes in the waveguide. Observe that the electric field has only tangential components in the plot of the plane. And this confirms our guess it's a TE11 mode. And you can plot the electric and magnetic fields for the other modes as well by using the edit source option. Now, here's a collection of the electric field and the magnetic field distributions for the different modes of the circular waveguide. The second mode, the fields are similar to the first one with the change in orientation. So it's a TE11 mode. For mode 3, look at the phase plot. It could be TE01 or TM01. View the field plot in that plane, and you can see it's a TM01 mode. And doing the same as we just did, when we look at the next two modes, they're TE21. So in this video, we showed how to simulate a dielectric field circular waveguide and calculate the cutoff frequency and view the different propagating modes. Now, what's going to happen if we change the radius? Will that cutoff frequency of the modes change? Will it be the same type of modes? Well, if we look at the cutoff frequency equation of the circular waveguide, the cutoff frequency is inversely proportional to the radius. That means that the cutoff frequency is going to decrease if we increase that waveguide radius. And the radius of the circular waveguide will intentionally be defined as a variable, and that will enable us to do a parametric variation analysis. And if you forgot how to do this, go to the lessons whose link is displayed on the screen's top right on how to set up a parametric analysis in AEDT. Setting up a parametric analysis allows multiple design variations to be analyzed using that one model geometry. Makes it simple and easy. And here's the rectangular plot of the phase constants for two different radius values. The cutoff frequencies are shifted to lower side of the waveguide radius as the waveguide radius increases. This is just one option of many that the AEDT student version can help you to really understand and really see how that model geometry variables can affect the fields. Thank you for watching this video, which details and simulates a circular waveguide example from David M. Poser's Microwave Engineering Reference Textbook. And if you want to find more information on AEDT, HFSS, or any of the ANSYS simulation tools, please visit ANSYS.com/courses today.